that we need to observe. Four things. The first one is this, that pastors have multiple roles, multiple role relationships. That creates some challenges. Someone comes to you, as I was saying at the end of the last lecture, to talk about a very personal thing, and the next time you see them, it's at a fellowship dinner and everybody's kidding around. It's confusing what your role is, where you fit. Pastors have this unusual role of being really knowledgeable about people, often about very personal things, and then kind of treating them as if you don't know that at other times. When you think about your multiple roles as a pastor with somebody, think about this. First of all, the most dangerous thing to think of is power. The pastor or the counselor has a lot of power, and it's easy to misuse that. It's easy to try to manipulate people. People are a little afraid of what you know sometimes. You have to be careful. There's also loyalties. Their loyalty to you, their loyalty to their family. You know, it's not uncommon that somebody comes to see you who on another occasion didn't like you very much, who had a problem with something you did or with a decision you made, or maybe their family did. Maybe it was their father or their mother. It's a kind of a tricky thing for pastors to handle. You go visit somebody in the hospital who a year ago really didn't want you to be their pastor. It's kind of a challenging thing. We've got these different roles. Pastors are, on the one hand, friends. We're authority figures. We speak for God. We're confidential counselors. All these things at the same time. So these roles overlap. Counselees, when they come to you and you gain their trust, they give you extraordinary access into their lives. You have a lot of power over them. And so you need to be very careful not to abuse that, not to give them advice that isn't from the Lord, because they can't tell the difference. They think that what you say must be true. Sometimes people want a special closeness with you. You're in this really intimate conversation about seriously personal things, maybe things they've never told anybody before. So now they really like this closeness. They kind of think of themselves as your best friend or something. You have to kind of keep that at a distance. They're not your best friend, but they are your friend. They're your flock. You love these people. You have to remember always that lay people do not see us as we see ourselves. Do you have that? Lay people, the people in our church, do not see us like we see ourselves. I see myself as one of them. I'm an ordinary guy. I go home and watch television. They see me as a man of God. They think I speak for God. I had somebody ask me, "Do you just pray all the time?" No, I wish I did, but no, as a matter of fact, I don't. They don't know what to make of us sometimes. And so we have to be careful of those roles, that we are not confusing or mixing up the power and the intimacy and the confidentiality of what's going on. Well, let me tell you another story. Let's say that her name was Becky. I don't remember her name, to tell you the truth. This was many years ago, and this young woman came to see me. She called, asked if she could have an appointment. She wasn't from our church. I didn't know her at all. When she came in, she was probably in her mid-20s. She was sort of spacey, a little weird. She wouldn't hold a sentence straight. You know, she wouldn't keep talking in a straight line. It was kind of hard to figure her out. She told me almost right away that she was coming off an affair with a married man. Then she told me that the married man had been another minister. Well, ding, 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 alarms are going off all over the place, you know. And she never told me who it was. I didn't know if it was a pastor I knew or didn't know. I didn't know what the story was. But I didn't trust her. Nonetheless, she came. She wanted to talk. Our conversations went all right. I don't remember much about what we discussed. But I remember the day that she was scheduled to come to see me at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. At that time, this is long before we had cell phones or anything, and in our church, usually people were still around at 4 o'clock. But for some reason or another, everybody left that day. They all had different things to go to, and the next thing I know, everyone's gone about 3:45, and Becky is coming, and I don't know what to do because I don't like the feel of this. But I didn't want to just cancel on her. She hadn't done anything wrong. So I remember at the time taking a little recorder. I used it for dictation. And I wore a jacket and I put it in the inside of my coat pocket. I thought, the tape isn't long enough to run the whole time we're together, but she doesn't know that. I'm not going to do anything wrong. I know I'm not going to do anything wrong. So I had this in my pocket and my plan was if she started talking about anything or doing anything that I didn't like, I would just pull it out and start it and lay it on the table. And of course she didn't do anything, she was fine. But it was a way that I was aware that I had to have a boundary. Well, that brings up the second area of boundaries that we have to have. We talked about multiple role relationships, being aware of who you are in this relationship. Probably the toughest, and the one we think about most, is sexuality and gender boundaries. Sexuality and gender boundaries. Some pastors are so careful that they won't see a woman at all. They don't want to take any risks. But I think that's a dangerous role for a pastor because half of your congregation are women and they've been entrusted to you by God. And you need to be a trustworthy pastor. And these are your people. You know them. You know they're trustworthy, almost always. So there are some things that we can do to be careful. But often, if we're overly aware of this, it turns counselees away. So, for example, in my office, there's a window about this big in the door. And anyone who walks by can see. If you can picture this, as I sit here, the counselee sits over here, the door is over here. So somebody walking by the window can't see the counselee. I like that. They can see me, they can see in the office, but they can't see the counselee. My office manager sits right across the hallway. I think that's safe. So I feel comfortable closing the door because people tell you personal things and they don't want somebody listening in. So we want to think about how we can provide a safe environment for the counselee, but also one that is safe for the counselor without violating confidentiality or a sense of safety when they talk with you. People will tell you some very personal things and they don't want somebody else overhearing that. And I trust them. If there's a situation that you don't trust, then you can take a little stronger precautions. But mostly these are your people, right? You know their names, you've been with their families. You're not worried about something going wrong. Don't make it worse by just overreacting. What are some issues to consider in this area? Well, one is your own personal vulnerability. Nobody has to know why you're leaving the door open, but if you feel like you're vulnerable, whether because of your own heart or the other person, take stronger measures. The setting. It's not good to be alone with somebody, and is especially not good for a youth worker to be alone with somebody of the opposite sex. Don't give a kid a ride home unless the parents know where you are, know what is going on, everybody's aware of the situation. Be very careful about this. Maybe it's different in the culture where you listen than in our culture, but we need to be very careful. Be aware of the setting. Another boundary is the content of the discussion. It's amazing to me that as I've sat with people, men and women, Sometimes folks tell you amazingly personal things, sometimes sexual things. And, you know, it's, you have to kind of guard yourself from your eyes getting big and going, what? So you have to be professional. That's very interesting. But it's also appropriate to say, I think I've heard enough on that. I get the idea. You also want to think about the counselee's vulnerabilities. Sometimes people, like an abuse victim, for example, is somebody who's sort of hypersensitive. I talked to somebody once who had been an abuse victim. I said, is there anything I do that makes you uncomfortable? She said, please don't touch me. Now, I touch people all the time. I often put my hands on people's shoulders. I give hugs. I just would have never thought of that. And it's hard for me to remember that with her because I like her very much and I need to be very careful. You also want to just think about spiritual protection. You pray, you ask the Holy Spirit to oversee a situation, all situations, every counseling. Things can get mixed up and confused. To ask the Spirit to give you discernment about what's going on, to kind of raise red flags if something isn't right, and to have accountability. You might say to your wife, I'm meeting so-and-so today. I don't tell my wife all the counseling appointments I have, but I might. I might on a certain, I'm seeing so-and-so today. I just want you to know that she's coming in to see me. You want to be aware of danger signals. There are danger signals. One is my own pride. I have nothing to worry about. I'm good. You want to be careful about fantasy. You find yourself thinking about somebody you've counseled with. That's dangerous. Comparisons. Boy, this person sure would be interesting, a lot more interesting than my spouse. That's pretty dangerous. Another kind of thing is be very wary of taking gifts. That can be dangerous. Somebody might just bring you a book that they think you would enjoy or something, but just be careful of gifts. Obviously, if you start sensing seductiveness or inappropriate physical contact, then you want to stop.
TVS Seminary is a nonprofit project. Our joint effort will bring about the common purpose of making Christian education available around the world and developing good Christian servant leaders. You have a unique opportunity to partner in this effort through your prayer and or financial support of TVS Ministry. For more information, please visit tvsseminary.com.
So, there are boundaries. There are times where you might say to somebody, I'd like you to meet with one of the ladies in our church. Or you have some other way. Some pastors and their wives counsel together because they enjoy doing that and they're both good at it as a team. That's fine if that works for you. If you're counseling anyone at an extended time, but especially a woman, you might just want to take notes after your meeting when they've gone. Just write down, what did you talk about? What was the point? So that if anybody ever says, what was going on? You can say, this is what we talked about. I have notes on it. Obviously, that's not foolproof, but it's useful. It helps you remember. The last two boundary issues are quite simple, straightforward. I mentioned one already. The third one is confidentiality. Confidentiality. We're expected to keep confidences, to not reveal what people tell us, to not use them in sermons, to not hint about it. Hey, Tom, you see Tom in the foyer of the church? Hey, Tom, how's that problem with your wife going? That wouldn't be good, would it? You want to say things like that. So there are times, I think, where you ask permission to talk to the elders or somebody. I think the hardest situation, I haven't faced this but once, is if someone tells you an issue that really is an issue of spiritual discipline, of church discipline. I don't know how to handle that. The confidence of that confidentiality versus the accountability to the church. the one time I faced something like that, I felt I handled it right, but the other people didn't feel I handled it right. So it was a case where I felt I needed to tell our elders what I had been told. But it's a difficult thing. The ultimate guide is what is loving. What is loving for this person, and what is loving to the church. By the way, if you run into a situation you just don't know what to do, find a pastoral colleague who doesn't know anything about it, who doesn't know the people, and talk it over with that person, because they can help you think this through. And I don't consider that breaking confidence when they don't know anybody. So that might help you, especially if you're just not sure how to handle it. The final boundary issue is quite simple. It's competency. Competency. You're not competent to handle everything. Someone says, my doctor has prescribed this antidepressant. You're not competent to say they shouldn't take it. Don't do that. You're not competent in some issues. A simple one for me that I ran into was when I was doing premarital counseling, and both the man and the woman had been married and had children. And now they're bringing two families together. Nothing wrong with that. I just don't know what the dynamics of that are. And I didn't have time to go study it and know how to ask good questions or give good counsel. I wasn't competent. Sometimes it's because it's a mental illness or other things like that. You need to know what your competency is. And if you're kind of above your pay grade, as they say, stop. You can pray with them. You can say, let's pray together and ask God to help. If you live in a community where they can be referred to a professional counselor, that's great. But if you don't, then take this to the Lord, ask God to help you know how to proceed, because you have reached your capacity.